dispel the illusion. She talked with relish and pleasure. Yes, I was up there right enough, I was. I always does the witches round here. Vicar. He complimented me last year and said I'd done a good job in the pageant as he'd given a New Year's steeple hat. A witch's hat wears out like anything else does. Yes, I was right up there that day. I does the rhymes, you know. I mean, the rhymes for the girls, using their own Christian name. One for Beatrice, one for Anne, and all the rest of it. And I gives them whoever is doing the spirit voice. Make me die of laughing, some of it does. See those boys sticking hair all over their faces and photographing each other. And what they dress up in. I saw Master Desmond the other day, and what he was wearing, you'd hardly believe. A rose-colored hat and fawn breeches. All the girls can think of it's to push their skirts higher and higher. And that's not much good to them, because they've got to put more underneath. I mean, what with the things they call body stockings and tights, which used to be for chorus girls in my day, and none other. They spend all their money on that. But the boys, my word, they look like kingfishers and peacocks. Well, I like to see a bit of color, and I always think it must have been fun in those old historical days, as you see on the pictures. You know, everybody with lace and curls and cavalier hats and all the rest of it. I lent Mrs. Drake my witch ball for the party. Bought that witch ball at a jumble sale somewhere. There it is, hanging up now by the chimney, you see. Nice, bright, dark blue. I keep it over my door. Do you tell fortunes? Mustn't say I do, mustn't I? She chuckled. The police don't like that. Not that they mind the kind of fortunes I tell. Nothing to it, as you might say. Place like this, you always knows who's going on and who's going with who. It makes it easy. Can you look in your witch ball? Look in there and see who killed that little girl, Joyce. You got mixed up, you have, said Mrs. Goodbody. It's a crystal ball you look in to see things, not a witch ball. If I told you I thought did it, you wouldn't like it. Say it wasn't. Say it was against nature, you would, but lots of things go on that are against nature. You may have something there. This is a good place to live on the whole. I mean, people are decent, most of them, but wherever you go, the devil's always got some of his own, born and bred to it. You mean black magic? No, I don't mean that. Mrs. Goodbody was scornful. That's nonsense. That's for people who like to dress up and do a lot of tomfoolery. No, I mean that the devil has touched with his hand. They're born that way, the sons of Lucifer. They're born so that killing don't mean much to them. Not if they profit by it. When they want a thing, they want it, and they're ruthless to get it. Beautiful as angels, they can look like. Knew a little girl once, 7 years old, killed her little brother and sister. Twins they were, 5 or 6 months old, no more. Stifled them in their prams. That took place here in Woodlake Common. No, it wasn't in Woodlake Common. I came across that up in Yorkshire, far as I remember. Nasty case. Beautiful little monster she was, too. You could have fastened a pair of wings on her, let her go perform and sing Christmas hymns. But she wasn't. She was rotten inside. You'll know what I mean. You're not a young man, you know what wickedness there is in the world? Alas, said Peor, you are right. I do know only too well if Joyce really saw murder committed. Who says she did? Said Mrs. Goodbody. She herself said so. That's no reason for believing. She's always been a little liar. You won't believe that, I suppose. Yes, said Peor, I do believe it. Too many people have told me so far for me to continue disbelieving it. Odd things crop up in families, said Mrs. Goodbody. You take the Reynolds, for example. There's Mr. Reynolds in the estate business. Never cut much ice at it, and never will. Never got on much, as you'd say. And Mrs. Reynolds, always getting worried and upset about things. None of their three children take after their parents. There's Anne. She's got brains. She's going to do well with her schooling. She'll go to college. I shouldn't wonder. Maybe get herself trained as a teacher. Mind you, she's pleased with herself. She's so pleased with herself, nobody can stick her. None of the boys look at her twice. And then there was Joyce. She wasn't clever as Anne, or as clever as her little brother Leopold either, but she wanted to be. She wanted always to know more than other people, and to have done better than other people. But don't you believe any word she ever said was true, because 9 times out of 10 it wasn't. And the boy, Leopold, well, he's only 9 or 10, I think, but he's clever, all right. Clever with his fingers and other ways, too. He wants to study things like physics. He's good at mathematics, too. Quite surprised about it, they were in school. He'll be one of these scientists, I expect. If you ask me, the things he does when he's a scientist, and the things he'll think of, they'll be nasty, like atom bombs. He's one of the kind that studies, and are so clever, and think up something that'll destroy half the globe, and all of us poor folk with it. You beware of Leopold. He plays tricks on people, and eavesdrops. Finds out all their secrets. Where he gets all his pocket money from, I'll never know. It isn't from his mother or father. They can't afford to give him much. He's got lots of money, always. Keeps it in the drawer under his socks. He buys things, a lot of expensive gadgets. Where does he get the money from? That's what I'd like to know. Finds people's secrets out and makes them pay him for holding his tongue. She paused for breath. Well, I can't help you, I'm afraid, in any way. You have helped me a great deal, said Peor. What happened to the foreign girl who was said to have run away? Didn't go far, in my opinion. Ding dong. Pussies in the well. That's what I've always thought, anyway. Excuse me, ma'am. I wonder if I might speak with you a minute. Mrs. Oliver, who was standing on the veranda of her friend's house, looking out to see if there were any signs of Hercule approaching. He had notified her by telephone that he would be coming round to see her about now. A neatly attired woman of middle age was standing, twisting her hands nervously in the neat cotton gloves. Yes, said Mrs. Oliver, adding an interrogation point by her intention. I'm sorry to trouble you, I'm sure, madame, but I thought, well, I thought. Mrs. Oliver listened, but did not attempt to prompt her. She wondered what was worrying the woman so much. I take it rightly as you're the lady who writes stories, don't I? Stories about crimes and murders and things of that kind. Yes, I'm the one. Her curiosity was now aroused. Was this the preface for a demand for an autograph or even a signed photo? One never knew. The most unlikely things happened. better sit down, said Mrs. Oliver. She first saw that Mrs. whoever it was wearing a wedding ring, so she was a Mrs., was the type who takes some time in getting to the point. Something you're worried about, said Mrs. Oliver. Well, I'd like advice, and it's true. It's about something that happened a good while ago, and I wasn't worried at the time. But you know how it is. You think things over, and you wish you knew someone you could go and ask about it. I see, said Mrs. Oliver. Seeing the things that have happened lately, you never do know, do you? You mean? I mean what happened at the Hallowe'en party, or whatever they called it. I mean, it shows you there's people who aren't dependable here, doesn't it? I mean, they might have been what you thought they were, if you understood what I mean. Yes, said Mrs. Oliver, adding an even greater tinge of interrogation to the monosyllable. I don't think I know your name. Lehman, Mrs. Lehman. I go out and do cleaning to oblige ladies here. Ever since my husband died 5 years ago, I used to work for Mrs. Luell Smith, the lady who lived at the quarry house before Colonel and Mrs. Weston came. I don't know if you ever knew her. No, said Mrs. Oliver, I never knew her. This is the first time I've been to Woodlake Common. I see. Well, you wouldn't know much about what was going on, perhaps at the time, and what was said. I've heard a certain amount about it since I've been here, said Mrs. Oliver. You see, I don't know anything about the law, and I'm worried always when it's a question of law. It wouldn't be anything to do with police being a legal matter, would it? Perhaps not, said Mrs. Oliver cautiously. You know, perhaps what they said at the time about the Cody, I don't know, some word like Cody, like fish, I mean. A codicil to the will, suggested Mrs. Oliver. Yes, that's right, that's what I'm meaning. Mrs. Luell Smith, you see, made one of those codicils, and she left all her money to the foreign girl. After her, and it was a surprise because she'd got relations living here and she'd come here anyway to live near them. She was very devoted to them, Mr. Drake in particular, and it struck people as pretty strange, really. They said Mrs. Llewellyn Smith hadn't written the coxswain at all, that the foreign bear girl had done it, seeing as she got all the money left to her. The lawyers were going to contest the will. I believe I did hear something about that, said Mrs. Oliver encouragingly. And you know something about it, perhaps. I didn't mean no harm, said Mrs. Lehman. A slight whine came to her voice. Mrs. Lehman, she thought, was presumably an unreliable woman in some ways, a snooper perhaps, a listener at doors. I didn't say nothing at the time, said Mrs. Lehman, because, you see, I didn't rightly know. Because, you see, I thought it was strange, and I'll admit to a lady like you, who knows what these things are, that I did not want to know the truth about it. I'd worked for Mrs. Luell Smith for some time, I had, and when one wants to know how things happen. Quite, said Mrs. Oliver. If I thought I'd done what I ought to have done, well, of course, I'd have owned up to it. But I didn't think I'd done anything wrong, really, you see. Not at the time, if you understand, she added. Oh, yes, said Mrs. Oliver. I'm sure I shall understand. Go on. It was about this codicil. No, you're... Yes, you see, one day Mrs. Lowell Smith, she hadn't felt too good that day, so she asked us to come in. Me, that was, and young Jim, who helps down in the garden. So we went into her room where she was, and she'd got papers before her there on the desk. And she turns to this foreign girl, Miss Olga, we all called her. And said, you go out of the room now, dear, because you mustn't be mixed up in this, or something like that. So Miss Olga, she goes out of the room, and Mrs. Lowell Smith tells us to come close and says, this is my will, this is. She got a bit of blotting paper over the top part of it, but the bottom is quite clear. She writes two or three lines of writing, and then signed her name. And then she says to me, now, Mrs. Lehman, you write your name there, your name and your address. And then she says to Jim, and I was doing her bedroom as usual, a bed sitting room she had because she had to rest a lot. And I thinks, well, one ought to really know what you've signed a thing, what it says you've signed. I mean, they always say with these higher purchase things, you should read the small print. Or in this case, the handwriting, suggested Mrs. Oliver. So I thought, well, there's no harm. It's not as though I was taking anything. I mean to say, I'd signed my name there, and I thought I really had to know what I'd signed. So I had to look along the bookshelves. They needed dusting anyway. And I found the one. It was on the bottom shelf. It was an old book. A sort of Queen Victoria's kind of book. And I found this envelope with a folded paper in it. And the title of the book said, Inquire Within Upon Everything. And it seemed then as though it was sort of meant, you know what I mean? Yes, said Mrs. Oliver, it was clearly meant. And you took out the paper and looked at it. That's right, madame. And whether I did wrong or not, I don't know. But anyway, there it is. It was a legal document, all right. On the last page, there was the writing that she'd made the morning before. New writing with a new scratchy pen she was using. It was clear enough to read, though, although she had rather spiky handwriting. What did it say? Said Mrs. Oliver, her curiosity now having joined itself to the previously felt by Mrs. Lehman. Well, it said something like, as far as I remember, the exact words I'm not quite sure of, something about a coxswain and that after legacies mentioned in her will, she bequeathed her entire fortune to Olga. I'm not sure of the surname. It began with a S, Semenov, or something like that, in consideration of her kindness and attention during her illness. And there it was, written down. She'd signed it, I'd signed it, Jim signed it. So I put it back where it was because I shouldn't like Mrs. Wellsmith to know I'd been poking about in her things. Well, I said to myself, this is a surprise. And I thought, fancy that foreign girl getting all the money, because we all know as Mrs. Lowell Smith was very rich. Her husband had been in shipbuilding, and he'd left her a big fortune. Mind you, I wasn't particularly fond of Miss Olga. She had a sharp way with her sometimes, and she had quite a bad temper. But I will say, she was always very attentive and polite and all that to the old lady. Looking out for herself, all right, she was, and she got away with it. And I thought, well, leaving all that money away from her own family, that I thought perhaps she had a tiff with them. And likely as not, that will blow over, so maybe she'll tear this up and make another will or cox it all after that. But anyway, that was that. I put it back and forgot about it. But when all the fuss came about the will, and there was talk of how it had been forged, and Mrs. Lowell Smith could have written that Coxdale herself, for that's what they were saying, mind you, as it wasn't the old lady who had written that, it was someone. I see, said Mrs. Oliver. And so what did you do? I didn't do anything. And that's what's worrying me. I didn't get the hang of things at once. And when I thought things over a bit, I didn't know rightly what I had to do. Well, it was all talk because the lawyers were against the foreigner. I'm not very fond of foreigners, I'll admit. At any rate, there it was. And the young lady herself was swanking about, giving herself airs. I thought, maybe it's all legal thing of some kind, and they'll say she's no right to the money, because she wasn't related to the old lady, so everything will be all right. It didn't come to court at all, as far as anyone knew. Miss Olga ran away. Went off back to the continent somewhere from which she came. Maybe she threatened the old lady and made her do it, you know. One of my nephews, who's going to be a doctor, says you can do wonderful things with hypnotism. I thought perhaps she hypnotized the old lady. This was how long ago? Mrs. Lowell Smith's been dead for, let me see, nearly 2 years. And it didn't worry you. No, it didn't worry me. Not at the time. But now you feel differently. It's the nasty death. The child that was pushed into a bucket of apples. Saying things about a murder. Saying she'd seen something. And I thought maybe, as Miss Olga had been murdered, the old lady... As Miss Olga had murdered the old lady because she knew all this money was coming to her. And then she got wind there was a false lawyer's police, so she ran away. Then I thought, perhaps. Perhaps I had to. Well, I had to tell someone, and I thought you'd be the lady who's got friends in legal departments. Friends in the police, perhaps, and you'd explain to them that I was only dusting a bookshelf, and this paper was there in a book, and I put it back where it belonged. I didn't take it or anything. But that's what happened, was it? On that occasion, you saw Mrs. Lewell Smith write a coxettle to her will. You saw her write her name, and you yourself and this Jim someone were both there. And you both wrote your own names. That's it, isn't it? That's right. So if you both saw Mrs. Lewell Smith write her name, then that signature couldn't have been a forgery, could it? I saw her write it herself, and that's the absolute truth. And Jim would say it too, if only he's gone to Australia. Went over a year ago, and I don't know his address or anything. To do? Well, I want you to tell me if there's anything I had to say or do now. Nobody's asked me. Nobody ever asked me if I knew anything about a will. Your name is Lehman. What Christian name? Harriet. Harriet Lehman. And Jim, what was his last name? Well now, what was it? Jenkins. That's right, James Jenkins. I'd be much obliged if you could help me, because it worries me, you see. All this trouble coming along, and if Miss Olga did it, murdered Miss Lewell Smith. I mean, and young Joyce saw her do it. She was ever so cock-a-hoop about it, Miss Olga was. I mean, about hearing from the lawyers, and she'd come to a lot of money. But now I can't help wondering if I ought to have said something at the time. I think, said Mrs. Oliver, that you will probably have to tell this story of yours to whoever represented Mrs. Lewell Smith as a lawyer. I'm sure a good lawyer will quite understand your feelings and your motive. Well, I'm sure if you'd say a word for me and tell them, being a lady as knows what's what, how it came about and how I never meant to, well, to do anything dishonest, in a way, I mean. All you did was to say nothing, said Mrs. Oliver. It seems quite reasonable. And if it could come from you, saying a word for me first, you know, to explain, I'd be ever so grateful. I'll do what I can, said Mrs. Oliver. Her eyes strayed to the garden path, where she saw a neat figure approaching. Well, thanks ever so much. They said you were a very nice lady, and I'm sure much obliged to you. She rose to her feet, replaced the cotton gloves, which she had twisted entirely off in her anguish, made a half nod, and trotted off. Mrs. Oliver waited until Pior approached. Come here, she said, and sit down. What's the matter with you? You look upset. My feet are extremely painful, said Hercule Pure. It's those awful tight patent leather shoes of yours, said Mrs. Oliver. Sit down. Tell me what you came to tell me, and then I'll tell you something you may be surprised to hear. Pure sat down, stretched out his legs, and said, Ah, that is better. Take your shoes off, said Mrs. Oliver, and rest your feet. No, no, I could not do that. Pure sounded shocked at the possibility. Well, we're old friends together, said Mrs. Oliver, and Judith wouldn't mind if she came out of the house, you know. If you'll excuse me saying so, you ought to wear patent leather shoes in the country. The trouble with you is, said Mrs. Oliver, beginning to wrap a package on the table, which she obviously recently purchased. The trouble with you is you insist on being smart. You mind more about your clothes and mustaches and how you look and what you wear than comfort. is a great thing. Once you've passed, say 50, comfort is the only thing that matters. But damn, I do not know that I agree with you. Well, you better, said Mrs. Oliver. If not, you will suffer a great deal, and it will be worse year after year. Mrs. Oliver fished a gaily covered box from its paper bag, removing the lid of this. She picked up a small portion of its contents and transferred it to her mouth. Then she licked her fingers, wiped them on a handkerchief, and murmured rather indistantly, "Sticky." Do you no longer eat apples? I have always seen you with a bag of apples in your hand, or eating them, or on occasion the bag breaks and they tumble on the road. I told you, said Mrs. Oliver, I told you I never want to see an apple again. I hate apples. I suppose I shall get over it someday and eat them again, but, well, I don't like the association of apples. What is it that you eat now? Pure picked up the gaily colored lid decorated with a picture of a palm tree. Tunis dates, he read. Ah, dates now. That's right, said Mrs. Oliver. Dates. She took another date and put it in her mouth, removed the stone, which she threw into a bush, and continued to munch. Dates, said Pior. It's extraordinary. What's extraordinary about eating dates? People do. No, no. I did not mean that, not eating them. It's extraordinary that you should say to me like that, Dates. Why? Asked Mrs. Oliver. Because, said Pior, again and again, you indicate to me the path, the, how do you say, Gemin, that I should take, or I should have already taken. You show me the way I should go, Dates. To this moment, I did not realize how important dates were. I can't see that dates have anything to do with what's happened here. I mean, there's no real time involved. The whole thing took place, what, 5 days ago? The event took place 4 days ago. Yes, that is very true. But to everything that happens, there has to be a past which is by now incorporated in today, but which existed yesterday, last month, or last year. Is not that so? Yes, that's so. At least I suppose it is. It might have been just some mentally disturbed nut who liked killing people, whose idea of playing with water is to push somebody's head under it and hold it there. It might have been described as mental delinquents, bit of fun at a party. It was not that belief that brought you to me, madame. No, said Mrs. Oliver, no it wasn't. I didn't like the feel of things. I still don't like the feel of things.
Is this a new character, one I know? No,
you don't know him. He is dead.
Oh,
when did he die?
About 2 years ago.
It sounds interesting, said Mrs. Oliver.
But I can't see, nor can I as yet, said Peor. But I think dates might help, dates of certain happenings.
Everybody thinks the foreign girl forged the will, and probably, said Peor.
Everybody was right. She was the one to gain by it, was she not?
Wait, wait.
Wait for what, said Mrs. Oliver.
An idea passed through my head, said Peor.
Mrs. Oliver sighed and took another date.
You return to London, madame, or are you making a long stay here?
Day after tomorrow, said Mrs. Oliver. I can't stay any longer. I've got a good many things cropping up.
Tell me now, in your flat, your house, I cannot remember which it is now.
You have removed so many times lately.
There is room there to have guests.
I never admit that there is, said Mrs. Oliver.
If you ever admit you've got a free guest room in London, you've asked for it, all your friends.
Not only your friends, your acquaintances, or indeed your acquaintances' third cousins sometimes, write letters and say, would you mind putting them up for a night?
Well, I do mind. What with sheets, laundry, pillowcases, wanting early morning tea, and very often expecting meals served to them. So I don't let on that I have an available spare room. My friends come and stay with me, the people I really want to see. But the others, no. I'm not helpful. I don't like being made use of.
Who does? Said Hercule, Peor.
You are very wise.
And anyway, what is this all about?
You could put up one or two guests if need arose.
I could, said Mrs. Oliver.
Who would you want me to put up?
Not you yourself. You've got a splendid flat of your own. Ultra-modern, very abstract, all squares and cubes.
It is just that there may be a wise precaution to take.
For whom? Somebody else going to be killed?
I trust and pray not, but it might be within the bound of possibility.
But who? I can't understand.
How well do you know your friend?
Know her?
Not well. I mean, we liked each other on a cruise and got in the habit of pairing off together. There was something exciting about her, different.
Do you think you might put her in a book someday?
I do hate that phrase being used. People are always saying it to me and it's not true.
I don't put people in books. People I meet, people I know.
It is perhaps not true to say, madame, that you do put people in books sometimes.
You're quite right, said Mrs. Oliver.
You're rather good at guessing at things sometimes.
It does happen that way. I mean, you see a fat woman sitting on a bus eating a curd bun, and her lips are moving as well as eating, and you can see she's either saying something to someone, or thinking up a telephone call she's going to make, or perhaps a letter she's going to write.
And then you get off the bus. You don't want to ever see her again. But you've got a story in your mind about somebody called Mrs. Carnaby, who was going home on a bus, having a very strange interview somewhere.
You know, it's quite true. I did sit across from someone in a bus before I left London, and here it is, working out beautifully inside my head.
I shall have the whole story soon, the whole sequence. What she's going back to say, whether it'll run into danger or somebody else in danger. I think I even know her name. Her name's Constance Carnaby. And only one thing would ruin it.
What is that?
Well, I mean, if I met her again on another bus, or spoke to her, or talked, or I
began to know something about her that would ruin everything, of course. Yes, yes. The story must be yours. The character is yours. Right again, said Mrs. Oliver. As to what you were saying about Judith, I think it's true. I mean, we were together a lot on the cruise, and we went to see the places, but I didn't really get to know her well. She's a widow. Her husband died, and she was left badly off with one child, Miranda, whom you've seen. And it's true that I've got a rather funny feeling about them. A feeling as though they mattered, as though they're mixed up in some interesting drama. I don't want to know what the drama is. I don't want them to tell me. I want to think of the sort of drama I would like them to be in. Yes, yes, I can see that they are, well, candidates for an inclusion for another bestseller by Adrienne Oliver. You really are a beast sometimes, said Mrs. Oliver. You make it all sound so vulgar. Perhaps it is. No, no, it is not vulgar, just human. And you want me to invite Judith and Miranda to my flat or house in London? Not yet, said Peor, not yet, until I am sure. You and your little ideas, now I've got a piece of news for you. Madame, you delight me. Don't be too sure. It will probably upset your ideas. Suppose I tell you the forgery you have been so busy talking about wasn't a forgery at all. What is it that you say? Mrs. Apjohn Smith, or whatever her name is, did make a cockstyle to her will, leaving all the money to the au pair girl, and two witnesses saw her sign it, and signed it also in the presence of each other. Put that in your mustache and smoke it. A forged codicil, said Mrs. Oliver, and there seems to have been a real codicil as well. Look here, Pior, isn't this all getting a little too complicated? It is getting incredibly complicated, said Hercule Pior. There is, if I may mention it, too much forgery about. Perhaps the real one is still in the library at Quarry House. I understand all the effects of the house were sold up at Mrs. Lowell Smith's death, except for a few pieces of family furniture. What we need, said Mrs. Oliver, is something like Inquire Within Here Now. It's a lovely title, isn't it? I remember my grandmother had one. Mrs. Lowell Smith, like many other rich women, enjoyed making wills. Changing about, the Drakes were well off anyway. I expect she always left them at least a handsome legacy. But I wonder if she left anyone else as much. As she appears, according to Mrs. Lehman, and according to the forged will, to that girl Oka. I'd like to know a bit more about that girl, I must say. She certainly seems very successful. Disappears. I hope to know more about her shortly, said Hercule Pior. How? Information I shall receive shortly. I know you've been asking for information down here. Not here only. I have an agent in London who obtains information for me. Will you find out if she ever arrived back there? That might be one thing I should learn, but it seems more likely that I may get information of a different kind. What about the school teacher? Said Mrs. Oliver. Which one do you mean? I mean the one who was strangled, the one who Elizabeth Whittaker told you about. She added, I don't like Elizabeth Whittaker much, tiresome sort of woman. She added dreamily. I wouldn't put it past her. Jeff thought up a murder. Strangle another teacher, do you mean? One has to exhaust all the possibilities. I shall rely, as so often, on your intuition, madame. Mrs. Oliver ate another date thoughtfully. Gentlemen.
you can kind of picture. Are enjoying it too. I will see you back here next Sunday. Have a wonderful night and a wonderful week.